Happy Women's History Month. Welcome to the first of three sessions for the Women's Entrepreneurship Symposium here at the United States Patent and Trademark Office, lovingly known as USPTO. We're so excited to have you with us today. I am Kara Duckworth. I am the Chief Corporate Communications Officer here at the USPTO. I have the pleasure of kicking off the series with today's exciting event. A biomedical and aeronautics engineer named Maryland's Top Innovator of the Year in MIT Review Magazine's Top 100 World Innovators for her work creating human-centered products, such as an interactive robot for kids with nervous system disorders. A daughter of Vietnamese refugees turned small business owners who co-founded the first co-working space in Phoenix, Arizona to create equity in the entrepreneurial ecosystem. A repeat winner of the Woman Business Owner of the Year Award, who founded a female-led community-based co-working space that has served over 13,000 women entrepreneurs in the launch and growth of their business. A skilled business developer with a degree in conflict analysis and resolution from George Mason University, who founded a company dedicated to making the government contracting business more accessible and understandable to all, which we all know is no easy feat. So bless her. These are just some of the women you will hear and learn from today during our Women's Entrepreneurship Symposium session. And we encourage you to tune in to our future WES sessions on March 15th and the 29th, where even more inspirational women will share their stories. As a member of our great USPTO communications team, I would be remiss not to mention our new Journeys of Innovation story on Pleasant Roland, the former teacher and successful textbook author who founded the American Girl Doll Collection to help inspire teen and tween girls to learn about history. The story is available on the homepage of our website, uspto.gov. Check it out and get inspired. I want to provide a few housekeeping notes before we begin today's program. If for any reason you get disconnected, you can just log back into the program at any time using the WebEx link that brought you here. If you miss a portion of the program, do not worry. We'll be posting the program in short order. And now to begin the program, I have the distinct pleasure of introducing my boss, the Undersecretary of Commerce for Intellectual Property and Director of the USPTO, Kathy Vidal, named one of Managing IP's top 50 most influential people in IP in 2022. Director Vidal leads one of the largest intellectual property offices in the world with more than 13,000 employees and with an annual budget of more than $4 billion. She is the principal IP advisor to the president and the administration through the Secretary of Commerce and is focused on incentivizing and protecting U.S. innovation, entrepreneurship, and creativity through initiatives such as the Council for Inclusive Innovation, which is chaired by Secretary Gina Raimondo and co-chaired by Director Vidal, a co-chair of the National Advisory Council on Innovation and Entrepreneurship, also known as NACI, from our friends at the Economic Development Administration. And of course, as the co-founder and with the secretary of the Women's Entrepreneurship Initiative, which just launched this past November, something very relevant to this audience. With that, Director Vidal, I will turn it over to you and Dr. Lathan for a conversation that I know many of us are looking forward to hearing.
Thank you, Kara. I really appreciate it. And good afternoon, good morning, everyone, depending upon where you are. Thank you for joining us as we launch the USPTO's Women Entrepreneurship Symposium. Throughout the month of March, we are pleased to be celebrating Women's History Month. Over the course of the month, we will highlight the women who continue to alter the course of history with their innovations, their creations, and their dreams. We have 3 weeks of programming, as Kara mentioned. That programming will highlight the role women entrepreneurs play in innovation and economic growth. Over those weekly sessions, we will discuss the importance of expanding opportunities for women and underrepresented groups in our innovation ecosystem. We will host women innovators and business leaders, and we will exchange ideas on how to improve the prospects for all women inventors and entrepreneurs. We will provide resources women can use to learn from and to apply best practices, and we will be with you on your journey. During the first session today, we will focus on the need for flexibility and adaptability in the face of change. We will explore how a foundation in STEM education prepared one remarkable woman to be a neuroscientist, biomedical engineer, inventor, innovator, CEO, and now author. Dr. Corinna Lathan received her BA in biopsychology and mathematics from Swarthmore College, and then an MS in aeronautics and astronautics. And if that was not enough, she has a doctorate in neuroscience from Massachusetts Institute of Technology. You heard some of her many accolades. Her work with children with disabilities and robotics has been phenomenal and featured in magazines, including Forbes, Time, and The New Yorker. She was, as Kara mentioned, Maryland's top innovator of the year and is one of MIT Technology Review's top 100 world innovators. And in March, a full-size statue of Dr. Lathan was featured at the Smithsonian as part of an exhibit on contemporary women in STEM. So I am very excited to be here with Dr. Lathan. Super excited to have this dialogue. And without further ado, I want to kick things off. So Dr. Lathan, it's so great that you've joined us today. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So proud that you're here for our launch of the Women Entrepreneurship Symposium. And I'm thrilled to share this virtual stage with you. So you are a brain scientist, a technology pioneer, and the CEO of Anthrotronics. How did you get your start in STEM, and what inspired you to pursue education in the scientific and technical fields?
So first of all, thank you so much, Director Vidal, for having me part of this conversation. Please call me Corey, and thank you for saying I could call you Kathy for the rest of this conversation. I was so thrilled to be part of this that I agreed to do it, even though I'm on my way back from San Francisco. I'm actually in the airport, so I apologize in advance if there are any hiccups due to that. But back to the discussion. So, you know, I was always fascinated by spaceflight. I wanted to be an astronaut when I was young. I loved Star Trek. And what I loved the most was the technology, the replicator, the holodeck, the tricorder, the transporter. So it was really the technology that enabled humans to live and work in space. And, you know, fast forward many, many, many years, I started a company, Anthrotronics. So Anthro-Human Tronics Instrumentation. And so I just, you know, in hindsight, looking back, it was really that intersection of humans and technology that really inspired me. That was what really got me started in going into science and technology. I wanted to create technology that enabled us to do cool things like fly in space.
That's fantastic. And I know you're much more degreed than I am, but I know I was only one of only a few women in my engineering program. And I know you were only one of two women in your doctoral program at MIT. And then later being the only woman faculty member in the College of Engineering at Catholic University. Can you tell us about that experience?
Well, I'm sure you can relate, but it can be exhausting. You know, on one hand, it's a lot of pressure to perform well because you're always visible. There's nowhere to hide. But it's also an opportunity because there is nowhere to hide. And so it's an opportunity to put yourself out there to overcome your fears, which, you know, I think we all have a lot of. So you know, I think, and even though I was the only one of two women in my program, and then the only woman faculty member, you know, there were other women faculty members in other departments, and I found a lot of support there. So I think continuing to look for support, even if in your current situation it's a little bit lonely, you can find your support through your network, through other networks. And I was always good at reaching out and building a network.
Well, and I love that you brought up networks, because one of the things that I talked about at our last Women Entrepreneurship events was the idea that women often, they get all their happy juices in their brain. You probably know what they are, given that you're a neuroscientist, but all their happy chemicals in their brain start circulating when they collaborate as opposed to when they compete. Unless they're competing with other people, then you've got the collaboration again. And we know from the data that women are so much more successful when they have that network. So can you talk a little bit about how you developed your network? And can you talk about the keys to empowering youth program you initiated at MIT?
Yeah, no, I agree. It's we do so much better and I have much better chance of success when we work together. And I think that's clearly been shown, proven out in the literature. And it was some of this literature that inspired me to start the KEYS program. And I remember when I was a graduate student, the American Association for University Women, AAUW, put out their first report on how America's school systems cheat girls. And it was incredibly powerful report to me. It talked about how even the best teachers communicate with girls and boys differently in the classroom. And basically in sum, 70, you know, most of the interactions with boys were, hey, that's great. Could you, and have you tried this? It was sort of constructive. And then most of the communication with girls was good, nice, fine, very status quo. So girls weren't being challenged. And the other thing that was in this report, there was a sociologist, Myrna Sadker, and she had a quote that said, if the cure for cancer was in the mind of a girl, it would be much less likely to make it to the world. And I found it so powerful. And I think at that point, you know, it's, you look around and you see a problem and you say, how can I, as a graduate student, help solve that problem and address that problem? And, you know, we all have power. We all have agency in this world. We just need to figure out what it is. And it turns out that MIT has a January term where anyone can propose an activity. And so I proposed an activity. I had some friends and we proposed an activity called Keys to Empowering Youth. And we looked at the literature and it came up with, there were three principles to this program. One was identifying stereotypes, making girls aware of the stereotypes in the world. We would cut out pictures from magazines and say, what are these magazines, what are they promoting us to do? They're promoting the boys to be doctors and engineers, and they're promoting the girls to be models. So awareness of stereotypes. The second was problem solving. At the time, Apollo 13 was my favorite movie. And there's a part of Apollo 13 where they put a bunch of junk parts of, you know, parts on the table. And they say, you know, make this brown filter go into the square filter. So we did activities like that. We said, here's a bunch of junk and here's a problem you have to solve. Turn off a light switch from, you know, a meter away. And then the final part of the program was mentoring. And we had both women and men engineers do activities with these kids, like make a hologram or fly something in a wind tunnel. Now, I mean, that was a long answer to how to get to Keys to Empowering Youth, but I think it's really those three components are still important today, 25 years later. So I think those three components that we identified for the Keys program are still relevant now.
Well, and I appreciate that. I don't know if you can see, but I'm furiously taking notes over here because, you know, as we launched Women Entrepreneurship, the initiative in November, and you know, I launched it with the secretary with the same idea. You want to find solutions. You want to bring them to people. And the more we hear from other people on their great ideas, the more we want to incorporate into the program. And I will say from the beginning, mentoring has been one of our three main pillars. Obviously, you need IP, you need to get funding, but the mentoring is so critically important. And I will also say you may be interested to hear that all of our leaders go through the Apollo experience for leadership. We go down to Houston and we learn from that because it's such great lessons learned there. So can you share a personal anecdote about a mentor who helped you on your professional journey?
Oh, gosh. So, you know, a traditional mentor I think we think of a mentor as someone who gives you advice that you follow, you know, people who you can trust. I think a mentor is more than that. It is someone who you can trust and someone who supports you, but it can also just be a peer who's going through the journey with you, who doesn't necessarily have the experience, who can give you advice, but it's people who you go through the journey with. So I think for me, the most impact has been my peer mentors, whether they're, older or younger or a little bit farther along or a little bit behind me, we're going through the journey together, and our journeys might look very different. I'll give you an example of a woman who was a few years ahead of me in graduate school, Dr. Deva Newman, who not only became a professor at MIT, she also was the deputy director of NASA and is now the head of the MIT Media Lab. Now, her career path is very different than mine. I did not want to stay in academia, where she got tenure at MIT, which is no easy feat. But our journeys, she's been so supportive of my journey, and I've tried to be super supportive of her journey. So I think that that's something just to rethink about what is a mentor, and peer mentoring is so important.
That's fantastic. And it's, we're certainly trying to provide mentors who maybe know a subject matter more than others who like intellectual property or law or how to get funding. So we're definitely working toward that. But I completely agree with you. Like I always feel like I've had kind of co-mentors, and I love the saying of you got to find your kitchen table board of directors. You got to find that group of women or that group of people who you can collaborate with, you can bounce ideas, they're going to push you. So if you complain about something more than once, you're going to make sure you're doing something about it. And so just really appreciate you letting people know that about thinking about it more broadly. So people don't have to worry if they don't have that very senior mentor to help them, that there's so many models for that. So your career has been phenomenal. And obviously you were introduced to STEM at an early age, and we know that it's vital to do that. Can you talk about what is being done to ensure more girls are exploring and pursuing degrees and careers in STEM?
Yeah, I'll mention two things. One is what I think of as the maker movement. Mm-hmm. I really loved that over the past decade plus, the maker movement has gained traction because there are very few biases. There's the classic example, if you ask kids to draw an inventor, they draw, an Einstein looking old white guy. That's not true with the term maker. I think that both classroom and informal education, places like the Kid Museum, I'm on the board of the Kid Museum, which is the largest dedicated maker space in the United States. It's just opened in Bethesda, Maryland. That places like the Kid Museum have done a great job at making the term maker accessible to everyone, all ages, ethnicities, genders. It's really, places like that have done a great job. So I would say the maker movement has been great. And then I would say on the flip side, we have really interesting initiatives, one that you alluded to in your introduction, AAAS, the American Association for the Advancement of Science, and Lyda Hill Philanthropies, named 120 contemporary women in STEM, including myself, to be ambassadors, STEM ambassadors. And it really was from the philosophy, if you can see it, you can be it. And they did a lot through this, but one of them was they made statues. And so there were very visible statues of women at the Smithsonian. And there are almost no statues of women living or dead in existence in the United States. So to have 120 statues of women was actually super powerful to see these, young boys and girls just show up and look at these statues and then look at me and say, wait, what is this? And so I think this, if you see it, you can be it. There's more of that, and there needs to be more of that. So I think your program is also really exciting.
Well, and that's so great. I will tell you that, ironically, I'm speaking at AAAS this Saturday night. So I may relay your story because I think you're just doing such great work. And on the makerspace, we just spoke about that this morning, where one of the things the USPTO is doing is trying to put maker software on laptops around the country. So many kids will, if they can't go in person to a makerspace, they can at least have a virtual makerspace with innovation software. So, and speaking of that, there's a lot of programs that we're involved in, including Camp Invention, where we taught 280,000 children last year about innovation and entrepreneurship. Are there any particular programs that you would recommend for girls?
Well, there's some great coding programs, Black Girls Who Code, coding for girls. There's I'm getting all the names mixed up, but there's great coding programs. So that's good. There's Project Lead the Way. It's more classroom based, but K through 12. So highly encourage young women to look at Project Lead the Way opportunities within their school. I mentioned Kid Museum. If there are other that goes through high school, you can actually, the program's more through eighth grade, but you can also volunteer at places like Makerspaces, particularly for high school. And I think, as you said, the online resources are growing. So I think all the robotics programs, there's FIRST Robotics, there's VEX Robotics. So I'm actually on the board of the Robotics Education and Competition Foundation, which has just started a drone competition, which is just super fun. I coached my daughter's robotics team for like 5 years, and we did several all-girls robotics teams. So one of the programs that I'm really excited about that's happening in Montgomery County, Maryland, where I'm from, is called Invent the Future Challenge. And this is a partnership between the schools and the Kid Museum. And I think it's a great model that others can learn from. And essentially, we work with teachers in the schools, and they have project-based learning, where a group of students, or even individuals if they want, can answer the question of what can we do to make to save our planet. And so the kids are really inspired in different ways. Some of them choose saving animals, some of them choose water or forests, or lots of different angles on that, depending on what they're inspired by. And so this Invent the Future Challenge is countywide, and we have we end up having, gosh, it's hundreds and hundreds of kids come together at the end of the year to present their projects. In fact, my own daughter participated in it several years ago when she was in middle school, and she and her friends were inspired by they actually read an article about how there's aflatoxins I'm in an airport, sorry. So they were inspired by the fact that there are toxins in peanut butter. And so they tried to figure out a way how they could eliminate mold in crops in Africa. So, I mean, it's crazy. They went down this path where they ended up designing a drone or an idea for a drone that could shed ultraviolet light on crops to prevent mold. It looked like a PhD thesis. So this Invent the Future Challenge really takes kids down all sorts of paths where they learn teamwork, where they learn problem solving, they learn the technical skills that they need. They're not being forced to take pre-calculus. They're actually just, you know, they're learning some technical skills that they need to maybe develop a prototype. So I'm a big proponent of these project-based learning.
Dr. Lathan, I apologize for some tech difficulties, but I'm going to continue with some of the questions that we have.
Okay.
If you don't mind,
I'm
no director of it all, but I figured, I would love to continue and ask you, in your experience, how can government, industry, and education work together to help sort of bridge this education gap that you have so aptly described?
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, what I was just mentioning is a good segue. We have a very entrenched educational system. It hasn't really changed that much since I was in school, you know, over 30 years ago. And it's still not working well for a lot of people. You know, the fact that the STEM pipeline has barely changed since I was in high school is a problem. So if government, industry, and education could somehow work together to change our education system and focus on 21st century skills, I mean, that would be the bare minimum to actually change the curriculum. To change the structure would be amazing. Like, who says that 12-year-old boys and 12-year-old girls should be together in the same classroom? I mean, it's absurd. So I think the gender base, the gender division, the fact that, I mean, you know, gender is a spectrum. I shouldn't even have said boys and girls, but the fact that we have gender-based education and age-based education, I think is an anachronism. So I think, I think that if we could overhaul our education system, that would be amazing. I don't think it'll happen. I think there's some simple things that could happen. So I won't get on my soapbox about the whole big thing, but a couple things. 21st century skills, like the problem solving, the teamwork, you know, organizations like Project Lead the Way are doing applied learning. I think that's great. I think that's a great step. I think one thing we could do is overhauling the way we teach math. My mother was a math major, a math teacher, taught math until almost the day she died. I was a math major. I was lucky because I was good at math and I liked it. It was like a puzzle to me. But the problem with our education system, A, if you're not good at math, you get steered away from STEM, and kids think they're not STEM kids if they're not good at math. Or if they don't think they're good at math, study after study shows that girls get better grades than boys in math, and they say they're not good at it, and they don't like it. So I think our math education is one area where if we could rally around it and change it, I mean, there are very few people who need to be taking pre-calculus, but yet our educational system, at least in Montgomery County, almost requires it. You know, I had to fight for my daughter to take quantitative literacy, which was one of the best math courses she ever took, because they said colleges want her to take pre-calculus. Well, guess what? The colleges didn't care that she hadn't taken pre-calculus, and she got into plenty of colleges. So, you know, so I think we have, you know, again, I could go on, but I'll stop. Yeah. Math. Let's change the math curriculum.
I thank you for saying that. I have a 9-year-old daughter and a 6-year-old daughter, so a fourth grader and a first grader. And my fourth grader is already saying, I'm just not good at math. I'm just, they're doing long division right now. And she's just very much like, I know I'm not very good at math. And I think my teacher knows that. So I'm just, you know, it's like pulling teeth to get her to do math homework. And so she already has the mindset of, math is not my thing. It's just not my thing. I'm more of an art person. We keep saying like, you're 9, like there's time for you to kind of figure this out. And just because you might not learn it this way, that doesn't mean you're bad at math. It just means there's got to be more creative ways to teach it or to learn. And that's okay. So I thank you for saying that. First of all, I totally agree with it. Plus new math is hard. So as a parent, it's
can't even help.
Yes. So your work ranges from developing robots for kids with disabilities, virtual reality technology for the space station, to wearable sensors for training surgeons and soldiers. Now, these are all incredible creations, and they are awe-inspiring for many reasons, but because we are the USPTO, we are focused on intellectual property. How important was it for you to obtain and protect your intellectual property as Anthrotronics was developing, and how are you using that IP today?
Yeah. So as I mentioned earlier, you know, I started my company Anthrotronics, Anthrohuman Tronics Instrumentation, and started that over 20 years ago, 1999, and started it to develop a robot, educational robot for kids with disabilities called Cosmobot. And, you know, it's so hard to tell the 20-year story of Anthrotronics quickly, but let me just say that over 20 years, we basically became known for using emerging technologies, robotics, wearable sensors, virtual reality, and people would come to us and say, can you help us solve this problem? So for example, NASA was looking at how can we do research on the International Space Station to see how our perception of depth perception, our perceptions of three-dimensional space changes for long-duration spaceflight. And so we had to develop a virtual reality system to fly on the International Space Station. We were looking at how can you put sensors into an instrumented glove so that soldiers who were trying to control a robot to go into a building to look for hostages could control the robot while maintaining a defensive posture and holding their weapon. So all of these things were new. It was new intellectual property. And so we thought it was really important that we protected that intellectual property. And we did it in different ways, you know, certainly trademarks, certainly patents. And this helped us to commercialize the technology. It helped us go out to find funding. It helped us to go out and find partners. And so we did this over and over. Interestingly, I will say that one of our last inventions, our most recent invention, was actually one of the very first mobile medical apps that went through the FDA. And the patent office has, there's been a lot of questions about patenting software. So our final invention, we actually were not able to get a patent on. We're now re-looking at that because things, you know, as new patents get issued, that changes. So we're actually re-looking at that. But over the, we've now merged. So this, my company, Anthrotronics, our final product is this app that we developed, and we're now partnered with a new company, Elite Med Health, that will be scale, you know, that is trying to scale that product. And that was our over 20 years, we really were an R&D company. We would develop something, a new technology, patent it, and then try and spin it off. So protecting our intellectual property was very core to our business model.
Thank you for sharing that. That's, first of all, your innovations are groundbreaking and really incredible. I have to ask, because I know I'm being told like, well, we're probably at time, but I got two more questions. One, because this is a forum focused on women and we are all, I think we are our worst critics and sometimes our worst enemies about failures. Can you share with us any mistakes or failures that you made in throughout your career and how you might have developed the persistence to overcome those failures?
Yeah, thank you for that question. And let me turn it a little bit on its head. I mean, as an inventor, I mean, I don't even see the journey as having mistakes and failures. It's just the journey. So, and I think it's so important to share that journey with all its, you know, with all its twists and turns and pivots that maybe were a result of a mistake. I mean, when you design an invention, I mean, you have prototypes and each prototype changes and you learn from quote unquote mistakes or failures. So I think I don't even see them as mistakes or failures. It's like what works, what didn't, and you move on. So I thought that story was so important to share that I actually wrote a book recently called Inventing the Future, Stories from a Techno-Optimist. And I tell you that because it's the techno-optimism that I think is so important to share, that despite mistakes and failures and pivots and, you know, macro conditions that, you know, we invented through 9/11. We went out for fundraising for Cosmobot, our robot for kids with disabilities, the night before 9/11. And so, you know, I mean, the world throws at you crazy things. COVID, we went out for funding for one of our most recent inventions when, you know, the January that COVID hit, and our funder was in China. So, you know, the world throws stuff at you. Now, were those failures or were those pivots, things that we learned from? There's a lot of amazing things to do in this world. And what I really wanted to share was that, you know, I'm a techno-optimist. I want to use technology to create, you know, the future.
Awesome. That's an awesome answer. So thank you. And I know Sean's going to play me out like it's the Oscars in just a second, but can I just ask my last question, which I think is a really important one, which is what is a piece of advice that you want to share with other young girls and women?
Well,
might be the hardest question, but
it is a really hard question. I would say, don't think about what you want to be. Like, don't decide, do I want to be an engineer, doctor, whatever. What do you want to do? What problems do you want to solve? And then learn the tools you need to do to solve that problem. Find cool people to solve the problem with. Because part of the joy of the journey is working, doing cool projects with cool people. So that's what I would recommend to everyone. Do cool projects with cool people and your life journey will be interesting and exciting and fun.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Lathan. I love that. You are a cool person doing cool projects. So I really appreciate it, Corey, for sharing your experience, your insights, and your vision with us today. I do apologize that we had tech difficulties with Director Vidal, but she was texting me, so she sent the regrets for having those difficulties. But we really, really appreciate hearing from you today. This was really an inspirational conversation. Thank you so much. You are an inspiration to so many women. So thank you for joining us for the Women's Entrepreneurship Symposium.